Welcome to Real Talk Live here at Planet Radio. You can also hear us at 103.3 FM and 1470 AM, Charlotte, North Carolina. Welcome to Real Talk Live. We were talking about women's health. We're going to continue and piggyback on some of the things we were talking about earlier. I kind of rushed through that, and I apologize. It wasn't really, I really needed to emphasize some points, and I kind of had to rush through it, and I want to take a little more time, even if it takes extra segments to talk about the three components in everyone's life, of course, men, women, children, body, mind, and the soul. And we're doing a series called Cross Training because I realize how important it is to emphasize that there's a couple different aspects to cross training. You got to get your head right, you know. If you've come out of some situations or the holidays or, you know, for some people it's a seasonal thing. There's a lot of changes environmentally and how we are supposed to somehow sort it all out and just get on with the day and just get things done. I mean, that's life. There's not a lot of thinking involved, but because I'm doing a series on it, I'm thinking more on it, and I'm going to discuss some things. But I took some notes, and I did some homework on codependency, and, you know, there's a lot of things to that that really key in. And I didn't really want to get into the topic codependency because there's some secular views, and then there's some counseling views on it that are important to take away from it. And I try to do what some things, well, I mean, what is suggested, just take what you want and leave the rest. And it applies to a lot of people. But some of the biggest, I guess, I want to say, violators of codependency are people that are caretakers. And if you're a caretaker, that's probably most of us to some degree. But if you're not, then that might not apply to you. But I wanted to touch on this topic, and I took some notes because I don't want to pretend like I know every intimate detail of what's going on in my life, much less someone else's, but I'm just speaking from my observation. And through my observation, I've noticed body language. You can pick these things up, and we can best learn how to live better and beyond the language barriers. One of the key things about communication is not just what you say, it's how you present yourself. And I look at a lot of other aspects. I'm going to point out more about charm school, touch on that, body language and how people communicate. Because a lot of people communicate with their eyes better. Some people are better communicators and they talk with their hands, things like that. But and then we're going to go further than that with it, of course. But I studied more and over a long-term period about the best aspects of long-term committed relationships. And the ones that stood out for me that had the best results. Overall, healthy relationships meant boundaries. Healthy communication. Not talking a lot, but healthy communication. Meaning there's boundaries. You set limits on yourself, and it starts with me. This means honesty, and it means sometimes not harsh in criticism, but honesty. It means shutting down the critical parent in your brain. All of us know that there's a therapeutic tool called the child parent-child relationship, the critical parent. And, you know, that seems to be the one that is most identified who we believe God is. And I think people put God in this picture that he's the critical parent. You can't do that. You can't do that. You can't do that. You couldn't do anything. You're gonna be running the other direction. And that's usually what people identify their relationship with God. This, you know, I mean, father, I mean, you look in the picture of a parent hovering over you like a helicopter, asking you, why did you do that today? Why did you do that today? And this goes on. And it's a perpetual problem because most people who've been through abuse, they identify God, the parent, as the abusive parent or the abuser in your life, and that's very common and typical. Fortunately for some of us, we're beyond that point. We realize, okay, no, that was a bad relationship with one of the parents of my, or two in this case. You come from a two-parent home, you might have a parent that was just kind of not very affectionate, or a father that was really kind of strict but like too lenient on the things that mattered, like real liberal. They talk today about socially liberal and conservative, financially conservative, whatever. But you know, these are the things that we grow up around. The messages we get is you're just a kid and you're getting bombarded, and then you grow up and you wonder why you're a full-blown addict. And I look at these recovery methods about therapy, the therapeutic tools, patterns in your life, Gestalt therapy, look it up. EMDR, PTSD, for people who've been traumatized, typically soldiers as well, or somebody that's suffered a severe accident, sometimes an amputation, on and on. There's so many broad topics, but why I narrowed it down to these is I just want to hit on that there are methods and therapeutic tools that'll help better identify what is going on and why you're at the where you're at when it comes to that relationship. Healthy relationships are broad, and sometimes you can narrow it down to the intimate things that do matter. All in all, you want to keep it simple, obviously. I don't want to get into all the therapeutic tools and the psychology behind it, but it does help to have a working knowledge of it. I talk about body language because I think that's one of the better ways to communicate what you want. If you have that connection with somebody, you don't always have to say anything. It's pretty easy for me to pick up because I'm a very quick learner, so I can tell right off the bat because I'm alert and my signals are going, and typically I don't miss a beat. I usually know what's going on with somebody before they even open their mouth. I know exactly because I got very good at listening to people and what they weren't saying. So that brings me to the next point about language barriers. Body language, number one, but number two, why certain people are not direct and not as assertive. That actually comes with training and learning. And if you learn to be appropriate and be able to be direct without over-talking a topic, I fall into this category. Unfortunately, it comes with this job. I was not a good communicator. I actually was really backward and shy, and I did, and I'm still very backward and shy. In fact, because I do what I do, it puts me in a situation where sometimes I think more people expect me to, you know, present more information, but sometimes I just want to just kind of retreat. And there is something to that, and I'll talk about it more at another point. But healthy barriers, healthy boundaries, that means sometimes we have to say, no, not tonight, I need a break. Instead of like making the conversation about that person, you know you've reached your limit. And I know that if I'm really paying attention to what's going on with me, I know I've already reached my limit. I usually don't know how to verbalize it. I fear rejection. I fear that somebody will think I'm going on my way to hurt them when I'm not. But typically, there's something going on in my relationship with that person or persons that I want to retreat or shy away. Sometimes I think what happens is that we've been so overwhelmed by some things and some people that we have to find ways to escape. You know, I was looking at some of the decisions I was making and what was pushing people away and what was drawing them. And a lot of times, if I'm not taking care of myself, I'm no good to anybody else. And that's just me talking. So I know sometimes I need a timeout too. And I need to do that two-day retreat. And I'm offering it to anyone who's interested. This two-day retreat is just a timeout. Walking, going to the river, just regrouping, a place to just escape. And I usually typically just do camping sites and or road trips or things like that. And part of what I've wanted to do with the radio show is take it on the road. and do just like what we've been wanting to do is just do Real Talk Live on everybody's porches, wherever we went at random. And I tried to do that last year, but we had a major family crisis occur. And I'm going to try to do that this year, is that I'm just going to go on the road, show up at people's porch, and we're going to do Real Talk Live right on their porch. I just want it to be the most natural environment. And one of the things I've learned is having got to know people in the Southwest, to the Northeast, to the Southeast, to eventually the Northwest corner of the United States, is that every different types of people all have a lot of things in common. We're all different, but the same, all the same, but very different. And that's why I don't see how the argument that today's center debate is on racial issues when so many people are so different in all kinds of ways. I mean, even you can't put groups of white people and find that there's anything the same. I mean, on the outside, if we're really to the point where we're only looking at people's outsides and we're not, and we're, it's really easy to compare somebody's outsides to somebody's insides. It doesn't work though. I mean, we are void of real relationships that are deep and commit. And I think that there is probably more deliberate reasons to that. I mean, we miss out on so much because we're caught up in this debate and we're not getting anywhere. So that's why I brought it up, because I realized that you can observe a lot by people's behaviors and interactions, because what they're not communicating, what they are communicating. Unfortunately, I'm not here to fix people's problems. But I do see, and I observe, and I see how some people, they let the problem get so out of hand, and then they blame other people because they didn't communicate what they wanted to begin with. You can't begin to believe how many people get hurt this way. If you simply know how to address an issue at the time it occurs, I say address it, don't let it drag out. I was just dealing with a neighbor who could have at least communicated that she had some things going on, she was busy. A lot of times people get upset and pissed off and take an attitude, and it's their fault to begin with. I can't be responsible for other people's behaviors and reaction. What I can be responsible is pay attention, know my signals, and also know that there's some things I'm just not going to allow myself to do. I'm going to put up boundaries. And I'm going to start looking at this a little serious. That was my wake-up call. So a lot of people are like, well, how do we better ourselves? Well, you can. You take care of yourself. You look at yourself and you say, okay, this is where I don't want to be. So I was, and I'm going to talk more about this because it affects your health. It affects how you make decisions. It affects how you plan your life. It affects everything. Putting healthy boundaries and having healthy communication doesn't necessarily mean you have to talk at all. It means you're taking care of yourself and you're setting healthy boundaries for yourself. When we take care of ourselves, we take care of our environment around us. When I'm a lot more calmer, a lot of things go a lot better, by the way. You ask some of the people around me, they're like, chill out. Why? I love problems. I mean, really. So anyway, I just wanted to share these things because it's obvious that we all have had setbacks. And that's really what boundaries are, is that it's a way for us to reset the button. I looked at some of the things that just got out of hand, and it doesn't take much for your problems to get out of hand, that I'll write it down. And before I know it, I'm like, I got writer's cramp. So writing a list down, that's where we start. I can't talk about a problem without offering a solution. There are things that we can do to reset that button. And by doing that, what I'm saying is you can push the reset button at any time in the day. Start with your list of things that are going on with you. And I look at, like, you can, a lot of people doodle, they draw on paper. And one of the things about journaling is that you don't actually have to write anything per se. You can put little notes, you know, things like that. So we're going to pick up here after this more about what to do about those communication barriers after this. Got a feeling higher than high. This is the real thing. Never mind the rain and the storm. We'll Okay, we're back and we're gonna offer some solutions. As I was saying, a lot of people, when I think about all the barriers, all the things we have to overcome just to get to the bottom of what's really going on, and there are a lot of factors, how we look at our parents today, how we can be more wiser, I mean, how we can set some boundaries, healthy communication versus just talking, how to be better assertive. There's so many things I'm still learning today. I don't want to pretend that I know a lot about this topic. It's just we do make mistakes and we learn from them and we apply them to maybe something that does work. Journaling, exercise, etc. We'll be back after this for more. Thank you for listening to Real Talk Live here at the Moonlight Lounge. You can also hear Real Talk Live at the Moonlight Lounge this spring at WGIV, the soul of Charlotte. So we're back here and we're wrapping up. And I just wanted to lay the groundwork for cross training because that's really the whole point, is to spend some time and really kind of pick apart some topics, exploit it, rip them apart, dissect some of these issues, and really put some a better perspective of it. It's very easy to let our judgment get clouded. It's very easy to let pictures and images. I mean, I shut the TV down because I realized there's a lot in that that predicts my, you know, I guess, I don't know, there's just a conscientious of the things that do matter. And when I tune a lot of that stuff out, a lot of times it helps me kind of decompress, sort it out, refocus. I just get a lot more done that way too. Instead of waiting for my favorite show to come on, which I think some people do that. I was never that way. I was like, when do I have time to do that? But this helps us focus on exercise, fitness, reading, things that actually help you grow you as a person. You can hear Real Talk Live at the Moonlight Lounge at 103.3 FM and 1370 AM, Charlotte, North Carolina.